Thank you, Victoria, and thank you, Dareth, for that beautiful prelude this morning. I kind of miss the organ and the piano preludes that we used to have. So I'm mandating right now that you continue and do that, maybe not every Sunday, but how about once a month? Is that okay? Twice a month? Something like that. Well, let me say good morning to all of you. Let me welcome you to the worship service, First Baptist Church of Sun Lakes. If you're here in the worship center or you're watching live on the internet, YouTube channel, we are absolutely delighted that you have joined us this morning for worship. If you happen to be visiting with us this morning, we're equally delighted that you are here, and we invite you to visit our welcome table, which is in the foyer behind you. Someone will be there to greet you and present you with a gift, and that gift comes in the form of a little blue bag. It has a couple of books that we know will be a blessing and an encouragement to you, and also some information about our church. Just a couple of announcements. This Tuesday morning at 9:30 in the CLC, Women in Focus is having a baby shower for the Choices Pregnancy Center. And so if you haven't signed up for that, please do so. There's sign-up sheets in the foyer behind you and out here in the hallway to my right, so they can kind of get an idea of how many to expect. And also let me mention that not tomorrow, but a week from tomorrow is the monthly fellowship men's breakfast at IHOP. Thank you very much. I was talking slow because I wasn't sure you were paying attention. But anyway, next Monday morning, 8 o'clock at IHOP, the men's fellowship breakfast, and we hope that all of you who are able to attend will come out. We have a good time. We have a room reserved for us, so we're by ourselves, away from the rest of the people in the restaurant, so we hope that you will attend. And then let me mention, on December 24th in the afternoon, that, of course, is Christmas Eve at 3 o'clock, Joel Jameson will be here playing some music. And of course, if you've heard Joel, who was our pianist for about 18 months, you'll want to be sure to attend that. He is quite good, as you know, and he's home from school, and he is offered to play for us. So we hope that you'll come. That's once again on Christmas Eve afternoon at 3 o'clock. And then let me mention, if you have a ministry announcement or something that you would like to put in our January edition of the Good News Chronicles, that information is due next Monday, not tomorrow, but next Monday. And if you happen to have a phone with you this morning, please make sure that it's turned off at this time. We greatly, greatly appreciate your cooperation week by week. And now before George, Pastor George comes to lead us in our worship, Chairman of our deacons, Gary Nessel, is going to come with an announcement. Gary.
Good morning. Each year, the deacons for Mother's Day and Father's Day give out a gift. This year, it was mugs. We did our best to distribute it as best we could, but not everybody would receive one. So, with that in mind, if you have not received a mug for Father's Day or Mother's Day, or just for the general purposes, they're available at the welcome table when you leave today. So please pick one up if you haven't done so. Also, each year the deacons have asked for an offertory for the staff. This is a staff appreciation offertory. And again, we're going to do this year. We'll be doing it this Sunday and next Sunday. So if you if you don't know our staff, you should. They're really very, very efficient and a great staff we have here. If you put your money in the offertory plate, make sure that you put it for the deacons / staff on there. If you write a check, make sure you write to the deacons with staff in the memo. We appreciate that. This Sunday and next Sunday. Thank you.
Angels from the realms of glory. Does that sound familiar? That's a Christmas carol, folks. Let's stand, shall we, and sing it together.
Story now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Shepherds in the fields abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with man is now residing yonder, shut the infant light. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Sages, leave your contemplation, brighter visions beam afar. Seek the great desire of nations, ye have seen the infant star. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Saints before the altar bending, watching, looking, hope and fear. Suddenly the Lord descending in his temple shall appear. Come and worship, Christ the newborn King. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Worship Christ the newborn King.
Be seated, please.
And why do we worship? Because he's worthy. In fact, he is infinitely worthy of our worship. Our Redeemer, the Lord Jesus Christ. The passage that is listed here in the worship guide under call to worship is from John 1. It says, "For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. How thankful we are that the Lord Jesus is the one who reveals to us the Father, who he is, what he is like, and the fact that we worship, we have come to worship the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Would you pray with me this morning? Oh, how we thank you, dear Father, for that grace and truth that came through Jesus, the very one who is the fulfillment of so many Old Testament prophecies hundreds of years before Jesus was born in Bethlehem. How thankful we are that the long-awaited, long-anticipated Messiah has come, that he was born into this world in order that he might live a perfect life, which he did, and die an atoning death, which he did, and rise bodily from the grave, which he did. And how we rejoice, Father, that just as the promises were kept and the prophecies were fulfilled related to his first coming, those promises that relate to his second coming will also be kept and will be fulfilled. We say with the Apostle John, even so come, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, how we thank you for your presence this morning. How we thank you that you meet with your people and that you delight to meet with your people. And Father, we delight in your very presence with us today. You've told us you'll never leave us, you'll never forsake us. And what a joy to know that we can come together. We can sing praises, we can pray together, we can fellowship with one another. Most of all, we come, as we sang in a moment ago, we come to worship you, our glorious Creator and Redeemer. All praise be to you. In Jesus' name, we pray together. Amen.
Our wonderful Lord left the throne of glory and came down to this earth to live his life, to be born here and live his life, and then die on the cross for our sins, all because of his wonderful love for us. Let's sing, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne Above.
Thou didst leave thy throne and thy kingly crown when thou camest to earth for me. But in Bethlehem's home was the cloud no room for thy holy nativity. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. Heaven's arches rang when the angels sang, proclaiming thy royal decree. But of lowly birth did thou come to earth, and in great humility. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. Thou camest, O Lord, with the living word that should set thy people free. Mocking scorn and with crown of thorn, they bore thee to Calvary. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. When the heaven shall ring and the angels sing at thy coming to victory, let thy voice call me home, saying, yet there is room at my side for thee. My heart shall rejoice, Lord Jesus, when thou comest and callest for me. We have a message to tell to the world. Go tell it on the mountain. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. The shepherds feared and trembled when low upon the earth rang out the angel chorus that hail our Savior's birth. Down in was born, and God sent us salvation, that blessed Christmas born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Well, we do indeed have a message to share. We tell it on the mountain. We tell it in the valley. We tell it on the coast. And I've lived in all of those places at one time or another. We tell the message of the gospel. Could there be a greater privilege than introducing people to the only one who can rescue them, change their hearts and their lives, and give them the assurance of heaven when they die? What a privilege it is to tell that message, and also at the same time, what a privilege it is to help others around the world, going places we'll never be able to go, tell that same message. The message of the gospel. As you know, we are involved in our Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, and I appreciate so much all that is being given during these days. Every cent, and you probably hear us say this every year, but it's always true, it's always the case, every cent that is given through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for missions around the world goes for that very purpose, so that our missionaries might stay on the field and keep serving and keep planting churches where they can and keep introducing people to Christ the world over. God bless you for your gifts toward this very, very important offering. God bless you for your gifts in addition to offerings like this. I'm always so thankful for people who tithe and then give above the tithe to special offerings like the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Some people may not be familiar with Lottie Moon, and I won't go into a lot of detail at this point, but she was a beloved missionary to China back in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and she gave her life, literally, invested her life in getting the gospel to the Chinese people. We have people today who are doing the same, following in those kinds of footsteps, telling the old, old story to new generations that the truth of the gospel might be known. God bless you. Thank you for your faithful giving. I'm going to ask Bob Burkholz if he'll come and lead us as we dedicate our tithes and our offerings to the Lord. Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we certainly don't give to get. We give to honor you and be a blessing to others. Your word tells us that if we are faithful to give of our substance, then you will bless us. Thank you, Lord, for providing for our many needs. We ask your blessing on this morning's offering and the remainder of this service. This we pray in your precious name. Amen.
Good morning. The song I'm doing this morning, many of y'all have told me it's one of your favorites. It's hard to pick favorites, but this morning it's my favorite. And I wanted to know a little more about it. I researched it a little bit. Mark Lowry of the Gaithers wrote it, and he's the goofy comedian. So just the fact that he sat down and wrote these words amazes me, but I wanted to find out how he did it. Reverend Jerry Falwell asked him to write the next Christmas play for him. So he started working on the words for the speaking part. In his timely matter, 6 years later, he came up with the song. But he started thinking about the mother and child bond, and he wanted to know what Mary knew about baby Jesus. And what he came up with were these questions that, you know, he wished that we could sit down and ask Mother Mary about.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is the great I am.
Mary, Did you know?
What a message. Come, thou long expected Jesus. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart, born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom bring, by thine own eternal spirit merit, raise us to thy glorious throne.
Amen.
Well, let me ask you to turn your Bibles, if you will, please, to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. We'll take a look at this marvelous song of praise. Actually, it's a song of praise from beginning to end. The song of praise that was sung by Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, who would prepare the way for the coming Messiah. I'll begin reading with verse 67. And so if you would like to stand with me at this time, you are welcome to do so. Luke chapter 1, and beginning in verse 67. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, and here's his song of praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, Zechariah here is speaking to John the Baptist, and you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Would you pray with me? Father, we could never give thanks enough for how you guide our way into the path of peace. And it's all because of the privilege of knowing the Prince of Peace, who is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. I pray, Father, that in these remaining moments, you will give your guidance, your wisdom, your understanding. As we look at this text, I pray that you will be our teacher today as we wait before you, as we trust in you, as we continue to worship you through your word. All glory be to you. In Christ's holy name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, last Sunday, we considered the amazing story of a man by the name of Simeon, who had been promised that before he died, he would see the Messiah. He would see God in human flesh, the salvation that the Lord was providing. Well, that day came, as you know, that day came. And the aged Simeon held in his arms the one who came to deliver his people. He held in his arms, didn't he, the creator of the universe and all things within it. Simeon held in his arms the one who came as God in human flesh, an event known as the incarnation. And he held in his arms the one who would ultimately die on a cross to pay the penalty of our sin in full so that we might have life forever. And in those moments, Simeon gave forth a mighty song of praise for the one who was indeed God's gift of salvation, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of God's people, Israel. Now, today, we're looking at a second song of praise in the Gospel of Luke. And as we've just seen in our reading this morning, it is the song of Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. We're told in Luke 1 that the angel Gabriel appeared to Zechariah as he was carrying out his duties as a priest in the temple. And the angel told him that his wife would bear a son. How did he take that news? What was his response? Zechariah asked the angel, and this is verse 18. He asked the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man and my wife is advanced in years." So apparently Zechariah was wanting some kind of sign. So that, I mean, an angel appearing and speaking to you is not signed enough. But anyway, he was interested in some kind of way that he could know for sure that what the angel Gabriel was telling him was right. Gabriel, in case you haven't noticed, we're old. We're way past childbearing years, way past. So what kind of sign you got for me? The angel Gabriel told him that he had been sent by God to give him, to give Zechariah this good news that he will have a son. But because of Zechariah's unbelief, the angel pronounced him unable to speak. Not exactly the sign he was looking for, I don't think. And for at least 9 months, Zechariah was completely silent. It wasn't until a few days after his wife Elizabeth had given birth to John the Baptist that Zechariah was able to speak again. I love it when music comes on in such a timely place. The angels are singing, bells are ringing, Zechariah is speaking again. And he was, and undoubtedly, think about this with me for a moment, undoubtedly, during that long period, you talk about a lockdown, during that long period of not being able to say a word, God undoubtedly worked in his heart, did some wonderful things within him as he began anticipating all that God would do through this son, this unique son, John, who would be born to him and Elizabeth. Think about how thrilling it must have been for Zechariah to look into that cradle and gaze into the face of the child who would call the entire nation back to God. Look into the face of the child who would proclaim the coming of God's Messiah. Well, fear and amazement came upon the people as they witnessed these events surrounding the birth of John the Baptist. In fact, as we see in verse 66, the people were saying, "What then will this child be?" The verse then says, "For the hand of the Lord was with him." The story is told of an old school teacher who always bowed solemnly to his class before he taught them. He was once asked why he did that, and he said, "Because you never know what one of these lads will turn out to be." That's a good attitude to take when teaching the younger generation, isn't it? Well, people were curious as to what John the Baptist would turn out to be. But of course, God knew what John the Baptist would turn out to be. In fact, God had foreordained John's purpose on this earth, that of preparing the way of the coming Messiah, something that was actually predicted all the way back in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 3 through 5. The name John means Jehovah's gift, or God is gracious. And that's the most fitting name for the one who would be the forerunner of the Messiah. Now, the people thought that Zechariah and Elizabeth should name their son after the father. Call him Junior, I suppose. That would be the only way to carry on Zechariah's good name. But no, he would be called John. The name was given by God to express the child's true identity. Think about this. By giving John a non-family name, God was showing that his mission and power would come from outside the natural world. That is to say, who John was could not be explained by his simply being the child of Zechariah and Elizabeth. By the way, names are very important in the Bible. Names are very important. And as we hear the names in this story, we begin to realize that God is up to something big. Zechariah, for example, means God remembers. Elizabeth means God is faithful. And as we've already seen, John means God is gracious. Then there's the sweetest name of all, Jesus, which means God saves. You see, Luke is telling the story of salvation here. He's telling the story of salvation, and Zechariah, Elizabeth, and John are part of that story. Of course, Jesus is the heart of the gospel story. He's the heart of the gospel message. God has remembered his promise to save, and it's all coming together, isn't it? It's all coming together in these early chapters of the gospel of Luke. Now, in verse 67 of Luke 1, we're told that Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit. And then in verse 68, he prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people." Think about this for a moment. Zechariah's last word before being struck silent had been one of doubt. His first word now is one of delight. Earlier, he had wanted a sign. Now, all he wants to do is sing. And what a song of praise this is in Luke 1. You see, genuine faith always expresses itself in joyous praise. Let me say that again. Genuine faith always expresses itself in joyous praise. And where there is no real worship, you have to wonder whether there's any true faith at all. Well, Zechariah's song is a song of praise. As I said earlier, it's a song of praise from beginning to end as he focuses on the promises of God. Now, let's take a look at these for just a moment. Notice, first of all, that there is praise to God for keeping his promise to David. Zechariah says in verse 69 of Luke 1 that God has raised up a horn of salvation in the house of David, his servant. Now, you'll recall that God had promised to David that he would be succeeded by his son Solomon. This son would build the temple, but there would come a greater successor, an ultimate one who would establish the throne forever. And that, of course, would be the Messiah himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. In Luke 1, verse 69, Zechariah mentions Christ as a horn of salvation. What do you suppose that means? Well, in the Old Testament, the lifting up of the horn refers to an animal tossing its horns in a display of power. An animal's horn is its weapon for defense and also its ornament of beauty. So in the coming of Christ to this earth, we have a mighty, mighty, indescribable display of power in his supernatural birth, or to put it more accurately, his supernatural conception in the womb of a virgin. Now, this great power of the coming Messiah is seen in what Zechariah sings about in verse 68 when he says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited us and redeemed his people." Oh, sing it, Zechariah, sing it. I love that. God has visited us and what? And redeemed his people. Now, that's power. That is indescribable, unimaginable power, supernatural power. Salvation is not a human invention. It's a divine visitation. By putting his son in a virgin's womb, God himself was visiting his people. He was entering our world from the outside because apart from his intervention, we could never have eternal salvation. Now, at Christmas, we focus on the baby Jesus and the humble surroundings of his birth. But folks, in the midst of all of that, we must not forget who that baby was and what he came to accomplish. The birth of Christ is not just a sweet little story we read to our children. It is the story of the mighty horn of salvation that God raised up for us. For us. I mean, we were lost in our sins, separated from God, headed for a devil's hell. We had no power within ourselves to change our character, our hearts, or our destination. Try as we might, we had no success in defeating sin and the spiritual bondage Satan had brought upon us. But then Jesus came. Thank God, Jesus came, and that changed everything. He lived a perfect life on this earth, God himself in a human body. Then the day came when Jesus died on the cross, bearing your sin and mine, and fully in that moment, fully satisfying the wrath of God for sin. Oh, I tell you this morning, God has raised up a horn of salvation for us. That mighty horn is Jesus himself, and there is no salvation apart from him. But thank God he came. Oh, that's good news. And the good news is that today, that mighty horn of salvation, the Lord Jesus Christ, is still changing lives. Does your life need change? You see, whoever you are, whatever you've done, Christ is able to save. As a writer of a previous generation has said, there is more mercy in Christ than there is sin in you. Pastor John Newton, the composer of the hymn Amazing Grace, could certainly testify to that truth. In the last months of his life, now this is the man who wrote Amazing Grace. In the last months of his life, after having faithfully preached God's word for years and years, and now barely able to speak, he said this, "My memory is nearly gone, But I remember two things, that I am a great sinner and that Christ is a great Savior. Well, that glorious truth shines through with extraordinary brilliance in the song of Zechariah as he declares that God has what? God has visited and redeemed his people. So first of all, in this song of Zechariah, there is praise to God for keeping his promise to David. Let's go a little further. Secondly, there is praise to God for keeping his promise to Abraham. So in this song of praise, Zechariah goes back even further than David. He goes back to Abraham. He mentions God's mercy toward our fathers in verse 72 and his covenant with Abraham in verse 74. You see, the promise to David rested on God's original promise to Abraham. For God had promised him that he would make a great nation of him, even though Abraham and Sarah were childless and were advancing in years. That sounds similar to Zechariah and Elizabeth. But God kept his promise and gave Abraham and Sarah a son in their old age. And through Abraham's obedience, God made his descendants to be a blessing to the whole earth. Now, ultimately, this covenant with Abraham, and I want you to follow this closely. Ultimately, this Old Testament covenant with Abraham was fulfilled in the coming of Christ into the world. So all the prophecies were coming true. Jesus was the Savior that God had always promised to send. In Luke 1, Zechariah goes on to talk about God's deliverance from Israel's enemies and how the people were to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all their days. You see, Jesus not only delivers us from sin and Satan's kingdom, he gives us purpose in life by calling us to serve. And to serve God is to glorify him in our worship and in everything else we do as we walk in holiness of life. So God wants to do something more with us than simply get us to heaven. He desires that we live for his glory while we are here on this earth. But first, we have to be liberated from our sin. We have to be set free in order to serve him, to glorify him, to worship him every day of our lives. Remember this, joyful service is a hallmark of a person who has met the risen Christ. Joyful service is a hallmark of the person who has truly met the risen Christ. Now, thirdly, there is praise to God for keeping his promise, not only to David, not only to Abraham, but also to Zechariah himself. Zechariah has rejoiced in God keeping his promises made to David and to Abraham. Now he praises God for keeping the promise he made to him personally. And this, of course, has to do with the birth of his son, John the Baptist. Zechariah spoke directly to the baby in verse 76, and you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways. Can you imagine Zechariah's emotions at that point? It's easy to just read that verse rather casually if we're not careful, but we must remember that there had not been a prophet in the land for 400 years. And now a prophet has finally been born, Zechariah's own son, John the Baptist. Furthermore, Zechariah had just gotten his voice back and was now using it to praise and prophesy. And what's more, his baby boy had an amazingly significant role ahead of him in being a forerunner for the Lord Jesus. The very one who is the God of this universe, the Messiah. So surely the words of Zechariah were filled with great passion and emotion. He probably struggled to gain his composure. Now, in his song, Zechariah goes on to focus on the depth of John's ministry. Notice this with me. As we see in verse 77, John would give to God's people the knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. And if you've studied the life and ministry of John the Baptist in the Gospels, you know that he did just that. He bypassed all the ritualistic practices and traditions that so impressed the religious leaders of that day. And he went right to the heart of spiritual life, for he knew that real change was internal, not external. John the Baptist preached repentance from sin, and he pointed people to the only one who could bring about that real change, and that one is Christ himself. You see, this is what the gospel offers. The only real forgiveness of sin there is, and those who have experienced God's forgiveness can testify that there is nothing like it. Nothing like it. It penetrates to the very depths of the human soul. Finally, we see in the song of Zechariah that there is praise to God for keeping his promise of sending the Messiah himself. Oh, I tell you, this is the most climactic part of all. Zechariah ends his magnificent song by speaking, and I love this part, by speaking of the sunrise from on high, who will visit us. And don't you love this? He says in verse 79, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace, not despair, not stress, not conflict, but peace. Peace from God. Peace that surpasses all understanding. Peace available to all of us. Why? Because the Prince of Peace visited us in order to redeem us, in order to change us and prepare us for a life of worship, ministry, service, and praise to God all our days. Before knowing Christ, we sat in darkness. We did. We sat in dark, spiritual darkness. And in the shadow of death, we had no assurance of eternal life, no hope of heaven, but the sunrise from on high visited us. And of course, that refers to the Messiah coming in order that he might accomplish what no other person who has ever lived or would live could ever do. And that is purchase our salvation on a bloody cross and 3 days later rise from the dead. I'm so glad he came. I'm so glad he paid that price in full that I might have life, that I might have the full forgiveness of sin. I'm so glad Jesus rose from the dead and is alive today. If he were not alive today, we would have no Savior. None. And Paul addresses that in 1 Corinthians 15. But because Jesus is alive today, we live. We live through him who gave himself that we might have life and have it abundantly, everlastingly, and live with him in heaven for all eternity. So, this is really what Zechariah was singing about. I mean, if you go back and read through this passage in Luke 1, you see this is what he's talking about. This is what he's rejoicing over. This is what he's singing about. And what a song it is. It's the song of redemption, a song of mercy, forgiveness, and peace. After all, Jesus himself said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. My friend, if you don't know Christ, you are walking in spiritual darkness. Until you come to know him, you are still living in the darkness of unforgiven sin. But if you will turn to Jesus for his forgiveness and the gift of salvation, the Bible says you will become a child of God. It's not a matter of putting our trust in ourselves and how good we may think we are or how good we think we have lived and all the good deeds and this and that and the other. No, it's a matter of putting our trust in the one who purchased our salvation. There is no salvation in human flesh, human works, human deeds, but there is salvation full and free in the person of Jesus who bought it on the cross of Calvary for you and I to be forgiven of all sin and have the gift of eternal life. Our hope is in him. Our joy is in him. Our peace is in him. Our future is wrapped up in him. It matters not what happens in this nation or in this world in terms of eternity, because that's already been settled. The victor has come. He has defeated the devil. He has won the battle. Praise his name. He came to visit us and to redeem his people. What a Savior we have. What a Savior. What a Lord. Praise his name. You know, we're going to be doing this for all eternity. We might as well get used to a little bit of it right now, even if this is a Baptist church. Amen. I rejoice today because my sins are forgiven. Had nothing to do with me. The only thing I contributed to my salvation was my sin. Our righteousness, the Bible says, is as filthy rags. But we trade those rags for the riches and the righteousness of Jesus. The Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin for us so that we might become what? The righteousness of God in him. If you ever try to add to grace, you nullify grace completely. You wipe it out as far as your own life change is concerned. You cannot add to grace. You cannot. You cannot. But that grace is available because he's the God of mercy, the God of salvation. Oh, what love in sending his son to accomplish salvation for us. The grace and mercy of God on full display through the conception and birth and life and death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation is in him and him alone. Do you know him personally? If not, he extends to you an invitation. Here it is. He says in the Gospel of Matthew, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, I will give you rest." That says it all, doesn't it? You see, Jesus died that we might live. He bore your sin on the cross, my sin on the cross, that his perfect righteousness might become ours. He didn't come to bring a political salvation or a social salvation or an economic salvation. No, he came that you and I might be made right with God. Period. And that right relationship can only come through the cross where Jesus died for sinners. Someone said, if Christ were born in Bethlehem 1,000 times and never in you, you would remain forever lost. But you don't have to remain lost. Turn from sin and turn to Christ. He is the answer. He is the solution. He is everything. Perhaps you would say in all honesty, oh, my need is so great. Here's the good news. We have a great Christ for our need. Whatever that need might be, whether spiritual or otherwise. And certainly the greatest need of all is for the forgiveness of sin and the gift of eternal salvation. And that's exactly why Jesus came to this earth. That's why he died in your place and mine. And that's why he rose in victory from the grave. Praise his name. Let's pray. Father, we can only imagine the joy, the emotion in the lives of people like Zechariah and Elizabeth and Simeon and the prophetess Anna, the shepherds, the wise men, those chosen of you to see the newborn Christ, the Redeemer, the one who has visited his people. Oh, Father, thank you for Christ and the salvation he offers. In Jesus' name, amen. I think we'll sing a Christmas song at this point. What do you think about that? Hark, the Herald Angels Sing. That's such a well-known tune and song, but I would encourage you to pay attention to these words. They're powerful. They are so powerful. After the close of the service, I will be here at the front to help in any way that I can. May God bless you, and may Christ rule and reign in your life, not only during this season, but all year round. Let's stand. Let's sing together. Hark, the Herald Angels Sing.
The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the sky, with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ my highest and adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. In time, behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the God emceed, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heavenly Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he bring, rich with healing in his wing. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give the second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn.
Amen. We are dismissed.